to the world. Subscribe now to the Hot 97 YouTube channel. It's Ebro in the Morning with Laura Stiles and Rosenberg.
Yo, ladies and gentlemen, this is Ebro in the Morning. Laura Stiles, she's already off. You got Rosenberg, and give it up. We are turning this show into Run the Jewels Radio to set off the weekend. LP, Killer Mike, fellas, what's going on? Y'all want to start with a song, or y'all want to talk that ish first? What y'all want to do?
Happy birthday to my son Malik. It's his birthday. He turns 26 years old.
Happy birthday, Malik.
Something worth celebrating Malik. This weekend.
Malik, who's been on Run the Jewels records.
Yes, he has.
Run the Jewels. Oh, no, actually, has he?
Blindside mixtape, where he said, I'm Malik, that's my dad. Yeah.
Right, Malik is
for the Pledge series, and Pony's for Run the Jewels.
We got to get Malik on Run the Jewels.
He's making beats now. They're whack, but they're getting better every time he sends one.
So before we go super deep on everything that's going on in the world and the important voices that you guys have at this moment, just from like a – you guys set off this sort of trend of artists who are on different paths coming together in a new stage in their career and sort of starting anew. Did you ever think, Mike, I remember the first promo I ever got from Columbia with the All Day I Dream About Sex single.
Adidas.
I hated that record.
And I know you did.
Mike hates that song.
Did you ever imagine, you know, after things fizzled out with the majors, that you would have your biggest run in your career in 2020?
I didn't imagine this, but I knew the creator had a plan for me, and my wife and my best friend who had played professional football wouldn't let me quit. They gave me some real goddamn fighter in terms of motivation. So I knew I couldn't quit, and I knew there was something for me, but I couldn't have imagined this. I wake up thankful every morning.
Mm. And what about you? What about you, LP? Because I mean, when your guys' run came to an end with Company Flow, it was a different kind of quiet. I mean, it was his. It felt like history at that time.
I'll be honest. I didn't even think I was ever going to be in anything else but Company Flow. So that was that ended in 90s after like 98. I was devastated. I was like, what am I going to do now? I only did a solo career because Company Flow died, and then for 10 years did, you know, Def Jokes, did the record label. I didn't have any idea what was going to happen. I didn't know. I just knew that I didn't really have any other options. I had forsaken school, you know, I got kicked out of high school and I didn't go back. I didn't really have any other job skills. So I really was hoping that it would work out.
And you saw success with other artists on Def Jux, but for you to be the guy on stage rocking 5,000 seaters and festivals all over the world, it just must be a crazy ride.
Yeah, it's
8,000.
About
10,000.
10,000.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Get out of here.
Cool. I'm on RTJ2 numbers. I got to catch up to RTJ4 numbers. My bad.
RTJ3 numbers was 12,000 in New York. So, RTJ4 numbers. RTJ4 numbers is me sitting in my studio online seeing if anyone likes the album.
I've been trying to get Killer Mike on the line for the last couple of weeks so I could pitch you guys a new number. I got a new number I'm gonna pitch at y'all.
I'm with it.
I got a new number.
I mean, I think that both of us, man, I think both of us are kind of blown away all the time by the whole thing. I don't think that we expected any of it. We recognized that there was something great that was happening between us, and that's it. You know, we just kind of pursued the music. We were like, oh, damn, this is really it. For us, it was more like, wow, this is dope. the music is dope, and it was making us, you know, it was making us want to make more of it. So the reaction to the music has been phenomenal, and I don't think that we expected to have any of this. I think that we're very aware of how rare it is to kind of be at this point in your life and have your career be kind of on an incline. It's
crazy.
It's usually you should be saying goodbye, you know, like gracefully, you know what I mean? Like, thank you for paying attention to us. And now I'm going to transition into being a, a podcaster or something. I don't know what you do at this point. I hope that I don't have to face that anytime soon, because, I'm just gonna have to get like a service industry job or something.
Nah, we got you, son. Run the Jewels 4 is doing how well, LP? Because I see you posting about the numbers and just in awe.
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy, man. I mean, you know, we I'll put it to you this way. We had our first week was usually your first week of sales is counted as a week, 7 days. We dropped it 2 days early. We dropped it on a Wednesday. We were supposed to drop it on a Friday, but we just felt like, you know, we had the opportunity to drop it. Everyone came to us and said, yo, because of some technical things, you could drop it now on Wednesday if you want. And we dropped it. So our first week sales was counted as was 2 days of sales. And we hit number 10 on the top 200 Billboard charts. And we've never done that. We've never even been in that bracket. And, you know, number one hip hop and R&B album 2 weeks in a row, like, you know, number one on iTunes, like globally, it's just been crazy. And it's something that we don't know. We don't know what's going to happen, especially now. We were just like, nah, just drop it. We, you know, like we were offered to stop, to not drop it. And we were just like, nah, if we didn't drop it, our fans would kill us.
The world needed it. I could say personally, I needed it at the time. Mm-hmm. And Mike, you actually, when it dropped, I could tell in your IG post, there was some apprehension in not putting out something to take away from the moment that of history, but also understanding y'all had a voice in the moment and the music fit the moment in history. Am I reading that right? There was a little.
Nah, it was no apprehension about dropping the shit. I had been wanting to drop it since April. I think that the universe works a lot more intelligently than we did. Any apprehension you may have sensed had nothing to do with drop. I wanted to drop it. I didn't want to seem to be pandering or pimping. That our music is constantly talking about, in some form or another, the proletariat versus the state. And I didn't, for the first time in my life, I really saw the proletariat take it directly to the state by burning 3 police buildings and letting the municipality know that this wasn't fair and just. And I didn't want to be seen to pander from that moment. But I don't even think that was in my IG post. I think I was ready to get it out. And I was actually happy that it got pushed up because, you know, people need, like, and when we write it in 92, we had Ice-T, we had Ice Cube, we had Public Enemy, we had BDP, we had a soundtrack to keep us fueled, you know, and beyond the riots, I was an organizer at 15. So the music is what kept me hopeful every Thursday when we went to meetings to meet and build and mobilize. So, you know, to me, I'm happy to be a part of that as the homies who are on the ground in LA, St. Pete, New York, and other places were calling me and letting me see live people playing the record as they were in the streets. I knew it was the right thing, and I knew that we hadn't pimped or pandered a moment, but rather we've given people, you know, a soundtrack to a successful protest.
This sort of just popped in my head when we started the interview, but one thing that at least a lot of people, Mike, we haven't discussed this yet, but one thing that people have felt encouraged by over the last couple of months is white people finally in some level of mass numbers starting to actually care about the pain and struggle of black people in America. And we're seeing it in the protests, how diverse it is. Are you surprised by that? Or did your guys' fan base almost give you an indication that you knew there was a new generation of people who maybe cared more and were more in touch than their parents?
Well, certainly that's our perspective. I mean, you know, that, like, I think that, I'll be honest, I think that this generation is not having it anymore, period. Like at a certain point, the institutions and the old machinations of the old guard that are built around very old and racist power structures and ideas start to become outmoded. It's no longer necessarily the natural will of the people. It's no longer necessarily the natural state of the human spirit. We've come along and evolved culturally in our heads, but the old structures are still there clinging on for desperate life. And I don't think that it matches up realistically with the heart and the will of the new generation, period. And especially with, you know, I think there's this big disparity between what they would, you know, the way that the control systems want to work versus the way that culturally we've all come together, be it through music or technology, or, you know, and the diversity of fan bases of people like ours, especially, you know, you mentioned that, like, yeah, we have an incredibly diverse fan base for sure. And
well, I've just been to shows and seen the reaction. Mike, you do call it. I've seen you do call and response shit that's so cool because I'm seeing kids who wouldn't be able to have their third eye opened any other way. They didn't grow up on Public Enemy. They didn't have all these records that they didn't have X-Clan like we did when we were kids. So it is.
You like X-Clan?
Come on, man.
Everyone liked X-Clan in New York.
Rosenberg. Rosenberg.
Brother Jay.
Yo, what you say?
Rosenberg debated getting a leather Africa medallion, and he was talked out of it. That's not a lie. That is not made
up. Hold on.
If he would have had the hat.
Hold on. I had one.
You had one? Mike, you had one.
Yes, shouts out.
Everybody's from Africa. Shouts out.
That's right.
My X-Clan walked through Brooklyn when I was in high school. Facts. Like they used to come full regalia through Brooklyn. So like that's 50 deep, like, you know, so whatever.
Mm. We are seeing the iconic statues and renaming of schools and roads and all of this stuff taking place right now. Killer Mike, are you enjoying seeing the America come to these terms? And did you think you would see it now?
I'm in the South. I've never thought I'd see the symbols of the Confederacy fall. I think that. So Frederick Douglass said that essentially that women and men should have gotten the right to vote at the same time in 1865. By them only granting the right to vote to black men, it caused a separation in the abolitionist movement and the women's suffrage movement in the South. And what you got after that was the Daughters of Confederacy, racist policy in schools and in local municipalities that allowed for high schools to be named for traitors like Robert E. Lee, monuments to be put up that are treasonous like Stone Mountain, and celebrated essentially the people who tried to separate this nation. Mm. You get that simply because everyone was not granted rights at the same time. So like Fannie Lou Hamer said, till all of us are free, none of us are free, right? Mm. So I never thought I'd see it come down in my lifetime because you have 100 years of miseducation in the South where poor white people are taught, this is your heritage, it's something to be proud of, instead of like black people are taught, these suckers were treasonous, and they lost the war. And just like you don't see Nazi symbols or symbols for Adolf Hitler or any of the Nazi generals in Germany, I've never felt as an American. You know, I've never felt it appropriate to fly the flag of losers. But in terms of the Southern culture, it doesn't bother me. I don't, as I drive down 75 into Florida, somebody who owns private land puts up three huge, Confederate battle flags. I don't care about that. That's your right to do. But I don't think that anything our tax dollars go on should support that, including but not limited to the largest Confederate memorial, which is in on the outskirts of Atlanta called Stone Mountain, where black people take fancy cars out there and ball every day. You know, there's also next to that a huge black village and incubator where a lot of cool things have happened. So it never bothered us much as Southerners, to be honest. We never thought it, you know, go because that was just a way of life. But I just want to tell people that taking down these symbols, however encouraging it is not the same thing as changing policy. I would like to see the same energy put into abolishing the 13th Amendment because the 13th Amendment calls for a loophole that says slavery is illegal in the United States unless you are a prisoner. The unless you are a prisoner part gives the system an incentive to lock up people who look like me and in addition to it, poor people. So after we take all these racist symbols down from in front of museums and parks and schools and that, let's make sure we plot, plan, strategize, organize, and mobilize so that we can capitalize on the moment to get policy change. We need to take that loophole out of the 13th because that loophole allows for us to be locked up at a higher rate and for people who write crime bills to make sure that we go to jail or for people who support Rockefeller drug laws to make sure that people who look like three of the people on this phone are more likely to be locked up depending on where. I'm sorry, all the people because LP didn't grow up rich. So, you know, whether you're poor, white or black in this country, those laws are not good for you. So I would like to see or I encourage more of that organizing because I know people are organizing on that behalf too. So the people that are in the streets, after we're done, let's make sure that we give ourselves to organizations that need mobilization and need numbers.
Killer Mike and LP have taken over today to get you ready for a weekend where we celebrate America's independence from the nation of Britain. At that same moment in time where we're talking about 1776, you had First Nations people decimated, and you had black African slaves in bondage.
Yeah.
How do you, LP, when these weekends come around, because you are and have always been an outspoken ally and advocate for progress and change and just social awareness, how do you talk in your groups about this weekend to enlighten individuals?
How do I talk about this weekend? I just ignore this weekend. I'm gonna be honest with you. I just ignore it, man. I mean, look, I grew, like you said, like earlier about people not growing up with Public Enemy. You know, like when I was a kid, I did grow up with Public Enemy. Rap music was one of the mechanisms that educated me on a perspective on all this stuff. That you had where you were fighting against the nationalism and the general sort of version of history that gets taught to you as a kid, that you just get fed this stuff. You don't have necessarily any reason or perspective in order to really challenge it. You go to school, you sit in a box, and they feed you what they feed you. Rap music was one of the things that was simultaneously going on in my head and challenging it. And it always felt like, oh yeah, this feels a little bit more real here. Like growing up in the 80s in New York City and seeing the poverty and the homelessness and hearing Public Enemy basically say, to hell with July 4th. It's one of those things that I just never, like, I don't know, man, maybe it's just different for New Yorkers, man. I've come to realize that growing up in New York is not growing up necessarily in America. You don't really share the same perspective that a lot of people that look like me grow up in America, are fed, that they grow up and they have these ideals that are fed to them. And in New York, it's always different. It's like, you grow up, it's multicultural. You have a diverse friendship, friend base. You're all on top of each other. It's a quote unquote liberal, place. So the ideas that get floated here are different. But for me, man, when it comes to July 4th, I mean, look, you're talking to a guy that in the Clinton era released a song called Patriotism that was at the time on Sound Bombing 2 Raucous compilation, which at the time everyone was like, this is the most paranoid. Why are you so paranoid? You know what I mean? And I think that you either have the veil lifted from your face or you don't. Either you believe blindly in nationalism and the things that the adults that came before you kind of fed you about them, or you trust your eyes and your own education and your heart and what your perspective is on the reality of it. I think the reason why we reject or that we resent holidays like July 4th isn't that we don't think that it was a good thing that America won its independence, right? But it is that we are rejecting the lies about it all. And it's more insulting and more difficult for us to deal with because we know that under the surface, there's this violent history, this racist history, this thing that we're not confronting. And we as people just sort of can't deal with the hypocrisy of saying, on the one hand, this is just wonderful and we should celebrate it. On the other hand, we're going to ignore and completely pacify all of the sins of this country. We don't want that to be the case. I would think that we would want it to get to the point where me, Ebro, Mike, fucking Pete can all be like, hey, this is great that it's July 4th.
Right.
We are proud that it's July 4th. Can't wait to celebrate the creation of this wonderful place, and yet, it's just too hypocritical and for us to just blindly just be everything's cool.
And it's also because, as you pointed out, it's because it's glossed over and ignored. The problems
are glossed over
and ignored and not addressed, and we clearly have not, which is why we're seeing everything we're seeing in the streets come to terms in an intelligent, useful, progressive, open-minded way about how we are all going to move forward as a nation where everyone has access to the dream, if there is one, whatever that means to you.
Right. And anger doesn't necessarily get directed at people who are openly dictatorial. You know what I mean? Like, if you're living in a dictatorship where they're just like, hey, shut up or we'll kill you, and it's open, there's really no, people wonder why are the cops vilified? Why are police vilified in America? Well, there it's not saying, hey, there's no use for police. It's not saying, hey, there are no police who join with the hope of doing something better, you know, good for their fellow man. The reason why it's so horrible and enraging for the entire world is because police represents something sacrosanct, something pure, something that we need, which is protectors from the people to protect ourselves, to help us. You know, it's way more insulting for someone who says, I am your friend when they do something terrible to you than it is for someone who says, I am more powerful than you, and you just shut up and the cards are on the table. That's why we reject July 4th. It's not because we say it's not a beautiful idea. It's because we said we can't stand the hypocrisy of it. It's driving us crazy. It's driving us crazy. We can't sit here and pretend that there's not something creepy about those four people on Mount Rushmore, you know, because we understand now how those faces got there. And in order for us to be pure, in order for us to be quote unquote proud of our union, we have to clean up, you know, we have to confront the reality of what it means to us. And so it drives us mad.
Killer Mike, everyone saw your passion, your pain, your everything you were going through when things in Atlanta turned violent some weeks ago. And you stepped in front of that microphone to speak on behalf of everyone. I would love to hear, you know, looking back on that moment, maybe some things that you maybe were too emotional to convey at that time.
I conveyed exactly what I wanted. I only paused and teared up a couple of times. You have to understand, much like LP, and rightfully Towson, New York is a different place. So he didn't grow up like, you know, the 2,000 miles that are in between him and the next coast. I grew up in Atlanta. So I grew up, if you're white Anglo-Saxon and Protestant in Iowa, and all you've ever been around is people like you, and all you've ever seen is white Iowan, culture. So imagine that chocolate. You know, Atlanta is, for me, all my heroes and villains were black. You know what I'm saying? My mayors were black. My police chiefs were black. If someone did something good for me, black. Someone did something bad to me, black. So I learned to judge people by the content of their character much earlier, simply because I didn't have this enemy oppress me. You know, there was an imaginary group of white kids in another school our teachers would tell us about that we had to do excellent because we were competing, but that was just imagination. That's why I'm a firm believer in African-American children going to African-American schools with other African-American children until they're 13, until their self-confidence is one where you don't throw them as minorities in a mix of people in a country that values other people's skin color or class above theirs, or ethnicities above theirs. So, you know, I just wanted to get that out. So for me, when you saw me speak, I was talking as an Atlantan directly from Atlanta, who grew up 4 miles from where the protests were going on and was only a couple miles from them. You know, I wanted people to understand that if we burn, loot, and shoot, which I participated in 1992, that if we burn, loot, and shoot all businesses, or the businesses that hire and support blacks, and more importantly, the businesses that are black owned, because many businesses are black owned, are first generation black businesses. If we do that, if we destroy our city, we're essentially destroying a fort for black America, and globally for Pan-African, you know, the world. Atlanta has been a host to many things. We're the city with the third most Fortune 500 companies. They're employed there, whether it's Coca, Delta, or big corporations employing us, or if it's small businesses like Pinky Slutty Vegan that's growing, or Big Dave's Cheesesteak, which was destroyed, along with The Agency, which is a very upscale restaurant owned by Blacks at Phipps. Both those businesses said, hey, that's okay. They repaired their businesses. They gave extra money for other businesses. After the young man was killed, a week later, Pinky and the brother whose business was destroyed, Big Dave, after he put his business back together, he helped other businesses, and then they gave a car to that young man's wife. Right. So what I was saying in that speech is, if we destroy these things, then we can't get that on the other side. Black people have to support each other because the government's not going to support you. Huge corporations are only going to support you as a show of vanity or that we down because they want to keep getting a dollar. But what brought Atlanta to prominence was small black businesses growing into larger businesses. A man named Alonzo Herndon, who owned a barbershop that only serviced white business elite, learned about insurance and went on to build Atlanta Life Insurance Company, the largest black insurance company that the world has ever seen. Employment was given. A whole district in black Atlanta came up from economic despair beyond middle class to opulence. We have that opportunity to recreate that. Atlanta's not black Hollywood. Atlanta, black Atlanta existed before Hollywood. 1906, after the riots, you have the first Atlanta conventions by Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois. So I'm from a over 100-year history of black social, political, and economic power. And what I wanted to see was that sustained. So let's be angry. Let's shout, rage, and mob if we need to. But the day after, we have to plot, plan, strategize, organize, and mobilize because Atlanta is a fort that's needed in the war to fight systemic racism.
Is there any understanding or learning that happened about the individuals that were causing that mayhem in the streets in Atlanta? Is there frustration in the youth because of, you know, things Absolutely. That haven't been addressed yet that, you know, need to be addressed now to understand how they're feeling?
Atlanta's as a mecca for black people is the pulse a lot of times to the feeling of black America. Black America is angry and rightfully so. The 4th of July celebrates a constitution and a land and this republic that was built on becoming a more perfect union, that was built on putting cultural, ethnic, and racial differences aside and becoming a more perfect union, a true vegetable soup of everyone. And it is not made good on that offer. And it has to make good on that offer. When you retreat back to the question that Elle answered that I didn't get a chance to address was, what do you do on the 4th? To be honest, what are black people doing on the 4th? I do the same thing I did in the 90s. I watched Dr. Amos Wilson. I watched John Henry Clark. I watched Minister Louis Farrakhan, who's going to be speaking on
that's
the 4th.
Right.
So that's what most of my rap buddies, that's what they're going to be doing. Most of the Atlanta that I know, the old guard goes and watch old Martin speeches or Malcolm and things of that nature. So we still barbecue. We still take the day off work. Any day you want to give me off work, I celebrate them all. Chinese New Year to Yom Kippur, I'm down. You know what I'm saying?
Word.
But yeah. but with that said, what I do in my household is try to focus inward on us. Frederick Douglass is the most photographed human being of the 19th century, essentially making him as or more popular than Barack Obama is, more popular than Ronald Reagan was. Why don't we just celebrate by reading his speech? What is the 4th of July to the Negro? I think, what is the 4th of July to the slave? What all Americans should do, because now notice he's the most photographed person. He's not just black history. Frederick Douglass is American history. So I challenge all Americans on the other side of this screen, on the other side of this microphone, to make sure that they read that speech by Douglass, you know, and for all my homies in my community in Atlanta, we'll be smoking joints, watching the minister together.
They are Run the Jewels. You can go get their new project, Run the Jewels 4. They have woken up early for us. That has not prevented them from smoking, though. You know what I'm saying? LP showed up to work, joint in hand. Mike showed up to work on time.
Joint in lungs.
Well, I was just gonna say, Mike, I think you smoking something from last night.
Yeah, I'm finishing up the duck from last night. Yo, yeah. Shay, don't be letting me smoke directly before bed. So you'd be like, you're not gonna smoke and lay your fat ass down. So I have to put it out.
Yeah, that's love, man.
I was gonna say, Mike, did you after that moment with Mayor Bottoms that first night? Did you've been to us in the hip hop world, you've been so prominent, your voice has been so prominent for so long. But I noticed on social media, new people posting Killer Mike. Like you really reached new people. Were you taken aback by that at all? Like it's I was like, wow, people didn't all know. And I'm like, I'm biased, of course, but
now,
it must have been interesting.
I'm down with all the 65 and up year old ladies that know me now. Shouts out to the mob, man. Like I got a whole mama mob that's
Yeah,
I mean, God.
You would have thought your real time with Bill Maher appearances would have done that, but this was different.
Yeah, but see, the mama mob don't be up that late. The mama mob be up for Oprah hours. Shouts out to mama mob, shout me out for and shouts out to because then the mama mob watches the news. So I really
you might
appreciate
Mike might not realize this, but he's also got an entire, he's got about 50 old people on the Jamie Moline side of the family that are now like hanging Killer Mike posters in their walls. I just wanted to say something real quick about from my perspective about Mike and when he stood up there to speak. And I will say that, you know, just because maybe it's not said enough, but I just want to say to Mike, man, thank you for being brave enough to take that on your shoulders, because that is not an easy thing to do. And you're going to have a lot of people who are going to pick apart and who are going to say what maybe you should have said or what they would have said or whatever it is. But and because of that truth, and you're very aware of that truth, not many people are willing to stand up and take that risk and say, you know what, I'm going to stand up here and speak my heart, and what comes of it will come of it. And there's a bravery in that I just want to recognize for you, man, because that's a personal risk that you took. And I know that you took it for the right reason. And as a friend, I'm in awe of that, and I'm inspired
thank
by
you.
That. So
I love and respect you. And I appreciate you, because oftentimes people don't think or acknowledge that I live the example that I encourage other people to have. And that's having people who don't agree with you, don't make culturally not from your background or look like you, to befriend them and to grow from their friendship. So I appreciate our bond, our friendship. I appreciate Run the Jewels as the group. And I appreciate you for supporting me in scary times like that, because, you know, I'm not playing with our career, but there are times where I say things that, you know, it could scare the shit out of people. And in the cancel culture world, it's good to know that yet your brother and ally and co-conspirator is encouraging you and not discouraging you. So shouts out to you, and more white people should do that.
And by the way, Mike, like, that moment was especially cool, because nothing you said was safe. You got people mad at you. Obviously, most people thought it was amazing. People who think,
yeah.
But you on both sides. I saw people trying to come for you afterward. I know it doesn't bother you, because I know how confident you are in what you do. But when I read people coming for you, like, you're not a revolutionary, like you were being too easy. That's how I knew you were spitting truth, because you spoke gray. You didn't speak black and white. You covered it all. Yeah. And that's not easy.
There's only one way to protect yourself from being criticized, and that's to not try. That's to not say anything. That's to not stand up. And that's what most people do. Because the truth of the matter is that's the reality. The second that you're on the radar, you know what I mean? You're known, and people are going to come for you. And that's all I'm trying to say to Mike. That's real.
Now, I appreciate you. I love you. I want people to know that, you know, the people that are coming for me that are out of the woke crowd, a lot of times, I understand, because a lot of people just woke up, you know. Yeah. I remember when I first read Autobiography of Malcolm X, I came here talking to my grandfather, who was born in 1922. Poppy, listen, I'm trying to tell you, we have to take the system down. And you know what I'm saying? So
he was like, point, my man.
He just looked at me and just say,
welcome aboard, buddy.
And just say, right? So, you know, but on the other side, the real danger, and I usually don't do this, but I'm going to name this business. There's a cafe for 40 years in Atlanta that's called the OK Cafe. Now, I don't want you to boycott her. I don't want you to try to destroy this woman's business. But she went up, and mind you, I was hanging out with Noriega, smoking joints, letting him eat Bankhead seafood for his TV show. And Tip just comes in from the gym and says, "Hey, I need you to go somewhere with me." And after our convention, I end up there with Tip. I wasn't even supposed to talk. I was standing in solidarity, and then Tip's like, "Killer." You know what I'm saying? So as for me, serendipity put me there, and she said things like me wearing a Kill Your Masters T-shirt, which I do 3 times a week. Because it's probably the same T-shirt, and I'm a dad, and I'm at home. And she said that was supposed to somehow be a signal for Black Atlantans to attack white Atlantans. And she said, why are Black businesses more important, and things of that nature. So although I don't want you to destroy her business, because she's been good to the community and providing good food and service, she's employed people that look like me, I do want people to email or send letters, or just that maybe she needs to have a conversation with me, because I thought what she did was evil and divisive of Atlanta. I think that she has a longer political agenda behind that, with dethroning potentially a black mayor or black city council members. So I think that there's something behind that's politically motivated. So I just wanted to say to her on national radio, and I hope this gets to her, that what you did could be possibly considered as divisive, evil, and along the lines of what the vice president of the Confederacy, Stevens, pushed when he said that blacks are naturally of a lower class than white people, and that is the cornerstone of the Confederacy. So I would like to encourage her, a fellow business owner, to at some point reach out to me and let's have a conversation, because I don't want you to think that I'm so pro-black that I don't understand the importance of the ecosystem of the wider Atlanta. I think that when the black community in Atlanta does well, all of Atlanta does well, because more dollars are in circulation for the all in my community. I thought you, what you did was ignorant, evil, and divisive, and I would like to invite you for lunch, not at your cafe, because I don't like it very much, but we could go to Slutty Vegan and have a vegan burger.
That was phenomenal.
Well, and also, as you pointed out, if you're taking offense by the term kill your masters as though they're talking about you.
About you, you're my man. Exactly.
You're projecting.
Yeah. Like, ma'am, you're not my master. Donuts are my master. And I'm breaking my Krispy Kreme defenses.
Cigarettes are my master.
Yeah. Right. Calm down.
Yo, man. Let's
chill out.
We got to hit that ooh la la before we get up out of here, because the way that magically sounds. And by the way, when I first heard it, I thought it was a sample. Is it a sample, LB?
Yeah. You mean the Greg Nice part?
The Greg Nice part.
It is a sample. It took me a long time to track down. You guys are DJs. You probably know. Rosenberg probably knows that acapella doesn't really exist in the wild that easily. Like, I had to like track it down.
Primo didn't have it.
I didn't even hit Primo about it. It was just kind of when I was making the beat. I think who hit me with that? It might have been Babu.
I don't know who.
It is a sample. And when we did the song and then we hit Primo up, we were like, we want to use this and we want you to do the cuts on it. And then we were like, I was in touch with Greg Nice because I was like, man, we got to get Greg Nice in the video. We got to have him, we got to have him be a part of this somehow. I got him through Z-Trip. Thank you, Z-Trip. And then that was originally when I was talking to him. Then through Primo. And we were like, yo, we have to put Greg Nice as a feature on this because we need to honor this dude. Like, if we're going to bring this spirit,
got to do it wrong. Right.
This song is not an old song. This song is a new song, but we imbued it with the spirit of the stuff that we grew up on and the legends and the feeling of what we grew up on in classic hip hop music. We knew that when we had this beat, we were like, this makes us feel the way that hip hop made us feel when we were falling in love with it. And so for us to put Greg Nice on there was really just a tip of the hat. Like, thank you, man. And by the way, people need to know your name. I don't want to just use your voice. I don't want to just take what you did and turn it into a Run the Jewels thing. I want to show the world what we are, what we're referencing, because you're our hero. You're a hero to us. So that was it, man. But it is a sample.
He's so incredible as a hook guy. Like, we forget how many records he made.
His voice is still amazing. He's definitely going to find his way back to the surface in terms of on the forefront, because I think
I'm making something for him. I'm making
straight up. So you can never destroy an ill voice. Let's say
that's right.
Now. There's a wave of nostalgia that's younger than people than us that's coming over hip hop, and hip hop is about to be 50. So what we have to understand is we're still so young that we're just building our nostalgia era. I look for people like Greg Nice to Ice T made a crazy record 4 or 5 years ago. Ice Cube could drop a crazy record tomorrow. Cool J could drop a record that'll fuck everybody's head up now.
That's right.
And what's going to happen is guys our age are going to get back into the people we love, and the people who are younger are going to find new ways to not only sample but to collab. That's what I predict in hip hop. I think that we're about to have Rolling Stones Muddy Waters moment.
Mike, because everyone got it so wrong when they used to say hip hop is a young man's game. It was only a young man's game because it hadn't gotten old yet.
Because it was only a few years older than us. Shit, everybody was young. But nah, man. Word to the gray hair in our beards, man. There's a wave coming. There's really a wave because I ride around and my 13-year-old, I play old school joints with her. So she was like, you know, I like female rappers from the 90s. And I'm like, what? But her mom's a hip hop head. And I was like, so who you like? You know what I mean? And she's like, I like Latifah. I like Light. I like Lauren. And she's 13 rapping Latifah, Light, and Lauren. You know what I'm saying? Which, you know, I was like, wow, when you get 17, maybe I'll play some Choice and Hoes with Attitudes. We'll have some conversations about.
I just think this.
I'll let you hear this gangster think... boo.
Yeah.
Yeah, gangster boo.
See, from the South, you know she hear it now.
Yeah, man. I just think this. I think that music is music. If you were to somehow get Jimi Hendrix on a record right now and put it out there, I don't think that anyone would check it. You know, if he were alive and he were to drop a solo on an album right now, I think that what Jimi Hendrix was capable of doing and what his art was would connect with people, period. And I think that when it comes to what you're saying, Pete, about that whole young man's game thing. Look, there's only two choices as you're in hip hop music. It's either that you being around for a while is a hindrance because you are stuck in an old mindset and you're not connected with what music is now, and you're not you haven't stayed sharp and you're not up on what is connecting with people now. Or it's an advantage because you have something in your back pocket that you know and you're connected with that is special, that you've identified as something that you could bring to people that isn't necessarily what everyone else is bringing to them. And I think that that's what Run the Jewels has managed to do, is that we are not saying we're recreating or making old music. It's actually cutting edge music now. Correct. But we are very clear about what our influences are, and we're clear about what the magic of that was. And we're trying to be honest about it and be like, hey, this is not an old record. This is an old feeling that we know. And I think that feeling still connects. It's the same way the joy connects and anger connects. It's a feeling. So
that's the irony of music in general, by the way, of hip hop.
Give that man his props. Bro. That man just made an elephant beautiful statement.
Yeah, no. We need to work a pause.
And real shit.
It's just so true, though, because when you think about it, a lot of the same old school heads who used to fight against growing hip hop, what made hip hop amazing was it was always about growing. It was always about paying respect to the classics while using new technology. When Grandmaster Flash invented the crossfader, the point was we could take the old and make it new. So to your point, as long as it doesn't matter your age, as long as you're still pushing it forward, that's it.
And come on, so, man. That's why you love Peter Rosenberg. Yes.
If you have something to say, you know what I mean? If it's an advantage, that's all it is, man. Nobody cares about your age. They just care if the music is hitting and it actually connects. And it's not that many people that can do that.
RTJ4 connects. Kinda, you know? That RTJ4 connects.
Yo, look, the way they flipped that silver sample, let's get to that joint real quick. And we got to play that Ooh La La. This has been Run the Jewels Radio, a Hot 9-7, one of one. Maybe we'll get another episode one
next
day
year.
When I can.
Now we do this every year.
I got to pay him next time.
can I just say that before we go, can I just say that as a born and raised New Yorker who's been making music and dropping albums since 1996, being on here and being on Hot 97 is a beautiful thing for me. It is. It means Absolutely. Something to me. You guys, this station has been the soundtrack to my life, you know, since I can remember. It was always a dream to be a part of it, to be heard by my fellow New Yorkers on a daily basis, to connect with the city that I love. And so I just wanted to say I don't take it for granted. It does mean something to me. And so thank you for that.
Absolutely. Of course. Man, let me add, as a Southerner who never thought that, you know, the time me and Elle grew up, if you weren't from New York, you weren't making rap music. You were just listening. So as a Southerner being played on the radio, you know, with my rap partner, I think it is the culmination of what Dre, you know, said, and the South got something to say. And I really appreciate, you know, I appreciate New York for listening. I appreciate New York for supporting Run the Jewels. I appreciate Hot 97. Thank you guys. And just to all the people who were there making this culture. I mean, not the people who are known and named from, you know, but the kids who were in those parks, man, just thank you. Because you guys are 60s now and even 70s. Just thank you guys, because what you did gave us a foundation. And I hope that not only in words and actions, but I hope that we figure out a way to reciprocate that leads to monuments and leads to economic development in those places and really turning the dollar. I'm with and pro making sure that the old guard of hip hop gets something out of this. And I'm very pro making sure the world becomes what you guys envisioned in that part, a multicultural, multi-ethnic, multiracial, all-inclusive art form, you know, based on rapping, b-boying, DJ and art. And I would add economy to that. So thank you guys.
And now we need applause for Killer Mike. Hold up.
I think Killer Mike needs to walk around with an applause button.
Or an air horn, something.
Hey.
Thank you guys.
Love y'all, brothers.
I love y'all. I'm headed to the gun range. Y'all be good.
Appreciate it.
Oh, man. Hot nine.